On this episode of Beyond the Marquee, I'm here with animation legend June Foray.
Hokey smoke!
Hey there, and welcome to another edition of Beyond the Marquee. I'm Steve Zarnecki, and today I have the honor of being with a legend here in Hollywood, a legend in animation. She's not only one of the oldest entertainers to be nominated for an Emmy, but she's one of the oldest to actually win an Emmy. I'm here with June Foray. Miss June Foray, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Very elated about the whole thing.
So let me ask you, people may see you and go, okay, June Foray, I know the name, what are the voices? So can you go through a roll call of some of your most popular voices you've done?
I started off as the cat in Cinderella. And then Chuck Jones called me over to Warner Brothers. I did Witch Hazel. Then after I did that, then Friz Freleng called me to do Granny. And I did so many things at Warner Brothers. And then I got a call one day from a secretary who said, I'm a secretary to Jay Ward. I don't think you know him. I said, no, I'm sorry, I don't. She said, he'd like to take you to lunch. He has an idea of a television series. So what the heck, a free lunch in Hollywood, what's wrong with that?
Who's gonna turn that down?
They started to tell me, they were having martinis, by the way.
That's what you do in Hollywood.
Yeah. For lunch. So they started to talk to me about a moose and a squirrel. And I thought it was a cockeyed idea. But then after a second martini, I thought it was a great idea. And I said, well, what do you want Rocky to sound like? He said, just a little boy who's kind of a wise aleck. So I invented Rocky.
Golly, Bullwinkle, people are depending on us. The world's waiting for our discovery.
So he said, you're going to do Natasha. And I said, what does she sound like? He said, don't make her Russian. We're having enough trouble with Russia. Right. She's from Pottsylvania.
Ah.
So I invented Natasha.
Hey up there, you dropped your safe.
Boris, where are you?
Yeah.
Boris, darling, you're alive.
This is living.
That was in 1958. Those were classic days. I miss them. They're all gone. I'm the only one left from Rockin' Bullwinkle.
Wow. So you are a living legend.
Thank goodness I'm still living. I got to be good friends with Chuck Jones and his family. And Friz Freleng, you know, it was a different time.
What were those times like? I mean, because the Friz Freleng, the Mel Blancs, the Stan Freebergs, all those legends, and you were part of that Rat Pack, in a sense. What was that like, those days?
They were classic times. Working with Mel was wonderful. Things were different. They were truly real. There was nobody who was taking advantage of you or misdirecting and saying, no, you can't do that, you know. It was a classic time, really classic.
Everybody loves the Smurfs. They've gotten a new resurgence in the past couple of years. Now they've come back again. Tell us about Jokey Smurf. How did you land that role?
I was asked to voice test, and I don't usually do that. They used to call me One Take Foray. I never auditioned. They knew that if they called me, I could impersonate somebody on the screen who probably didn't do a good job. And I looked through the script, and I saw Jokey, who laughed, and it said H-Y-U-K. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I thought, that's the voice I'll use. Like that, you know. And they said, that's great.
I brought you a surprise. I guarantee you'll get a big bang out of it.
You've done Grandma Gummy for the Gummy Bears. You did Grandma Fa for Mulan, which was just a classic. As your career has advanced, do you find there are characters you no longer can do that you could do 5, 10, 20, 30 years ago?
Hokey smoke. I can still sound like Rocky.
Okay.
And I worked this week, and I was still Granny for Looney Tunes.
Hubba, hubba. How about you set me up on a date with your granddaughter, huh?
That's me. During the war, I was a whack.
Hate to break it to you, but you're still a whack.
So let's talk about Granny for a second. Now, when you did this character for the cartoons with Tweety and Sylvester, you were a lot younger at that stage, and now you've reprised your role again for the recent Looney Tunes cartoons on the Cartoon Network.
Correct.
And you're Granny again. But you've kind of...
When I was young, I wasn't old enough to be Granny.
Right.
And yet I was playing Granny.
Oh, my! You're going to love it, Tweety. Now you can fly around outdoors without worrying about the bed or putty cat out there.
Now that I'm old enough to be a granny, I'm still doing granny.
What is that like when you think about then and now? It kind of feels like you've gone full circle.
I'm continuing what I started when I was very young. And to know that people appreciate that I'm still doing Rocky, I'm still doing Granny, and I did Cindy Lou Who in The Grinch, and she only had one line, and yet people love Cindy Lou Who. I get fan mail from all over the world, and they mention Cindy Lou Who.
Santa Claus, why? Why are you taking our Christmas tree? Why?
Also, I did a very sweet voice similar to that in The Twilight Zone. Do you remember the doll who killed Telly Savalas?
You don't have to tell me about episode 126, The Living Doll, my all-time favorite Twilight Zone episode.
My name's Talking Tina, and I'm going to kill you.
I'm not doing it any justice. Maybe you can. But one of my all-time favorites. Tell me about that. Tell me about that experience.
Well, it was entirely unexpected. I did the voice of Chatty Cathy, the doll. You pull the string, and the doll said, my name is Chatty Cathy. I love you. Please change my dress.
Let's play house. Please change my dress.
And she was a sweet little thing. My agent called, and he said, how would you like to work in the Twilight Zone? The Twilight Zone? Wow, I would love to do that. And they said, we want the same sweet voice as Chatty Cathy. So I read it first. My name is Talkie Tina, and I'm going to kill you.
Hello?
My name is Talkie Tina, and I'm going to kill you.
I love the final line. When she does kill the mean husband, the wife picks her up. The wife had never heard her speak before.
Right.
So the wife picks up Talkie Tina, and Talkie Tina looked at her and said, my name is Talkie Tina, and you better be nice to me. That was a chilling moment.
My name is Talkie Tina, and you'd better be nice to me.
What is it like working with this whole new generation of voice actors who are now doing the Looney Tunes characters?
They're wonderful. But unfortunately now, so many times when we record, it's not ensemble. Mm. We record lines separately. And you know, you can't respond correctly. You know, if you're angry, you really don't know it, because you don't know what went on before.
Right. So, yeah, there's a magic when you're reading all together and you're able to interact.
Ensemble. Right. Yeah.
So tell me about the new show that you just won the Emmy for, Garfield. Tell me about that.
Yes. Mark Evanier is a wonderful writer and director and producer. He's just been a wonderful friend. And he loved Witch Hazel, but naturally couldn't do Witch Hazel again.
Right.
So he made Mrs. Cauldron a witch. He called me once and he said, I put your name in for an Emmy. Bob Bergen, who does Porky Pig, he called me and he said, oh, by the way, you've been nominated. He's on the board of the Television Academy, but he said they approved it. And three other people were also nominated at the same time. And I thought, I'm not going to win because these other four actors are wonderful. And I was just a witch.
Right.
Well, they opened the envelope and said, and the Emmy goes to June Foray. I was so amazed. I got a standing ovation for about 3 minutes.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it.
What was it like? What was that moment like?
It was astounding to me, really. But it was so gratifying. After all these years, I had never been nominated before. And at this late age, you know. But it was a thrilling experience, it really was. It is so beautiful, isn't it?
Oh, it's amazing, yeah.
When I got it, and I tried to lift it up. Have you lifted it?
I haven't. Do you mind? Can I try?
Yeah.
Oh boy, you're right. That's about, 15 pounds maybe?
It must weigh at least 15 pounds.
Wow, yeah, it's most beautiful and well-deserved.
It is beautiful, yeah.
Any comments, anything you want to say to your legion of fans who have been so loyal and just have, you know, grown up with your characters and it will continue for decades to come? Anything you'd like to...
I want to say to you fans, thank you for letting me arrive at the point where I could receive an Emmy, or I could receive all these wonderful attributes and the Walk of Fame. It's all yours, and I thank you very much for it.
Well, June, I want to thank you for joining us here on Beyond the Marquee. It is, it's been my pleasure, and I know the pleasure of everyone watching to have you here and to not only talk about your Emmy win, but to get a little bit of a snapshot on your life and in your amazing career. So thank you for joining us. And
thank you. You're wonderful. I appreciate that.
No problem. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you once again for joining us here for Beyond the Marquee, and we will see you next time. Thanks so much.
Bye now. See you next time.
Most people may not know you actually have a role in Jaws.
I did the voice of the boys out in the sea. I've made more money out of Jaws in residuals. You know, sometimes I see an old picture and I say, oh, I did that voice. I got a residual check for 8 cents. I don't know what it was for. The gross amount was 12 cents and they took 4 cents out for taxes.
Unbelievable.
This has been a Studio Money-Free production.
Check out Beyond the Marquee online. Like us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube channel, or follow our tweets on Twitter. Thanks for watching.
My name is Talkie Tina, and you're watching Beyond the Marquee.